With a quilt that has batiks or fabrics that are tightly woven, you will want to go to the tatting thread. Now, the reason that we've chosen the DMC is that it on the outside, it's kind of rough. It's rough, and it isn't polished, and we want it to not be polished, because if it's polished, it'll slide in and out of the fabric. And this is not polished, so it'll cuddle and it'll hold the layers together, and that's a very important thing. I want to also show you, I thread needles a lot different, and it's always a good thing to see that there is another way of threading. Okay, I've trimmed this thread at a slight angle, pull the tail down really close in between my fingers, and I want to slide the eye of the needle over the thread, and then you can just pull it right through. And you don't have to thread it this way, it's just that there is another way. We want to cut an arm length of thread, and not any longer. What happens if you do it longer is that you double the movements of the arm. So you want to just do that arm length. We're going to tie a quilter's knot, which is, if you make a circle of your thread and grab the tail with the needle and wrap it twice, and then sew through the wrap, and that will give you a quilter's knot. So we've tied a knot. Okay, we're going to start to the right. We want to take a stitch, and the stitch needs to be a good half an inch big, and pull your thread through, and we want to three finger spacing, whatever that is for you, and do another half an inch stitch. I'm going to do a couple of these, and I'm going to explain why this works so much better than the safety pins. This basting is called the herringbone baste, and most of you know that I came from the garment industry, and this is a baste that has been done for hundreds and hundreds of years. And the reason that it has been used for that long is because it is really efficient. Now, I found in quilting that a lot of the basic sewing techniques have been lost, and this is one of them that has been lost. And I think that it, once you see that this works so well, that you want to make sure that you use it when you're basting. And I'm doing just a little back stitch because there's no need to tie a knot, so if you do a small back stitch, it'll hold it well enough. The reason that this herringbone baste works so well is that the stitch goes across and then it zigzags down and then across again. So you're getting, the thread is actually holding, just by its own tension, holding those layers together. And I find that it is much, much faster to baste with this technique than it is with the safety pins. Now I'm going to go just a little bit further and I have one more thing to do. You want to make sure that you use only a beige or a white thread. We want to keep any kind of color fastness problems or bleeding problems from the thread going into your quilt. So it's very important not to use weird colors or off brands. If you use an off brand, you never know if they've stabilized the dyes in the thread so that it won't bleed onto your quilt. So make sure that you use a good, just stick with DMC, quite frankly, and one spool will last you years and years. So it's worth the little bit of investment of trying to find it. I have found the DMC tatting thread in Joann's and sometimes in Michael's, but Joann's usually carries it pretty consistently. So you might want to look in Joann's and get it there. Now, what I find to be really helpful when you're doing this kind of basting, and of course, there's no safety pins involved, so the safety pins are catching on each other as you're quilting. You also, once you've basted this, you can just put it away and not have to worry about whether or not the pins are going to break the fibers or cause any kind of rusting, or, you know, you can just forget that it is even, well, you don't want to forget it because you do want a quilt, but you want to, you know, relax with it. Now, when you are doing this type of basting, when you get ready to sew, you don't want to sew on top of the basting or quilt on top of the basting. You want to, just the area that you're quilting, you want to just clip the thread like this, and it pulls out so easily, and it's much easier to remove than safety pins, and then you just throw that into the trash. And you only want to open the area that you're going to quilt, and make sure that you open that area or pull the basting thread out prior to the quilting. So you don't want to quilt over this basting thread. You want to pull it out just before you start the quilting process. Now, I do a lot of trapunto, and this is the only kind of basting that truly will hold the trapunto and not allow it to shift and pull and cause all sorts of problems with your quilt later on. Now, I'm going to just go ahead and finish the basting process so you can see what the entire thing looks like when we're done. You can see this is how your work piece should look. Now, if you're doing really fine work or trapunto, you'll want to make your spaces just a little bit smaller for more control. Now, at this point, we're going to pull the whole quilt. It doesn't matter what size it is, whether it's a, you know, just a wall hanging to a king-size quilt. You want to pull the whole quilt forward towards yourself. And I always pull the batting and then unroll the back. Make sure the back is nice and flat without any tucks or folds or wibble wobbles or threads, you know, all of that. I want to keep that nice and clean. I do keep a masking tape roller right next to whatever I'm working on to make sure I keep it clean. Now you have your batting right on top, and we also want to keep it clean and pull any kind of debris out. This gives you an opportunity of making sure that everything is nice and clean, because those little dark specks show up really badly on a quilt. We want to flip this all the way back and unroll the top. Now, can you see how the board is holding, the boards are holding everything? So you want to unroll the top, and we're going to start the basting process again. We have everything really lays nice and flat and even and smooth. I also use this time to kind of get to know my quilt. So I look at it and kind of decide how I'm going to quilt it or how I really don't want it quilted. If there's any seam problems, you can unroll it. And if there's like a seam that has twisted, because the board's right there, you can press right on the board and not cause any problems. It just makes such a huge difference in the control that you have, so that you can correct almost anything using the boards. And when I first started, I did baste like everybody else. You know, you put it out on the floor and do all of that craziness. When I figured out the boards, oh my goodness, it was like night and day. I used to actually get my husband to help me baste, which was not really good for our marriage. He didn't like that at all. So once I figured this out, it just made such a big difference. This is what your piece will look like entirely basted. At this point, you can fold this up, put it in a pillowcase. You can start hand quilting. You can machine quilt. You can do all, you know, everything that you need to do, because everything is really secure. And folding and moving it around, nothing will move at all. It will stay exactly where you basted it.